Hello, in this module, we will discuss the business dynamics from technology push to market pull. The French Dion Bouton created one of the first motor cars from an existing horse carriage. Like in the early days of motoring, first modern electric cars are built by pioneers or specialists. Today's development also started with retrofitted combustion vehicles. A logical way of innovations, since it's less capital intensive and relatively fast to realize. Tesla, in its pioneer days, used a Lotus Elise chassis to hand build and electrify the first Roadster. Small series EV specialists, like the Dutch Spijkstaal, were already in business for many decades and realized the first dedicated electric garbage truck, the EcoTruck, already in 2009. The first electric city bus, the E-Bus, was based on a retrofitted standard VDL diesel bus. After the diesel was removed, it was converted into an electric bus with in-wheel motors. The inventor of the wheel, E-Traction, led a consortium to build two buses plus infrastructure. Charging infrastructure. Great achievements, but most pioneers and small series specialists lack the investment power. Moreover, the cost of small series production and retrofitting is fundamentally too high. These products were depending on innovation subsidies, but cannot compete in the long run. And last but not least, most prototypes were not reliable and lacked design for serviceability. There was no adequate after-sales service, which is needed to keep the vehicles in operation. Still, without the pioneers, we would not have at the development level of today's EVs. Many of them are more or less industrialized successors of these prototypes. In 2013, the example of the E-Bus led to the world premiere of the OEM-built VDL Citea Electric. The pioneer Elon Musk had the investment power to build the mind-blowing Teslas. A new car brand, now including a global service network and supercharging infrastructure. In fact, Tesla is the first new automotive original equipment manufacturer since long. Existing OEMs now really benefit from the innovation by pioneers and new companies. This is also true for the new developments in the charging infrastructure. One of the current technology leaders in fast charging is ABB EV Charging Infrastructure. This new business unit emerged in 2011 from a student startup company, Apion. And ABB is now again the technology partner of, among other, BMW, VDL and Fastnet. Fastnet now builds one of the largest fast charging networks in the Netherlands and Europe. Innovative partners in the supply chain with added value are crucial to build the business. To achieve economies of scale, electric platforms can easily be shared by a model range. Various mass-produced parts can be crossed over from other models to further reduce the cost. This is best practice in the automotive industry, and EVs will not be an exception of the rule. But due to the simplicity of the electric drivetrain, also small series niche products will be affordable. In the automotive industry, most parts are supplied by so-called Tier 1 system suppliers. The added value of the OEM car manufacturer in production is often quite low, only 15 to 25%. For traditional OEMs, electrification is difficult since they depend on a reliable supply chain. They also have to balance current profitable business with loss-making new EV business. This includes decisions about investing in upstream battery production or downstream charging. Tesla, however, can concentrate on a gradual upscale of the new dedicated EV production chain. They are more vertically integrated since they want control of innovation and value in the chain. Rethinking the supply chain is still a big challenge. What will be the most added value at lowest cost? Making everything in-house or outsourcing crucial parts of the value chain to specialist suppliers, especially battery pack production and dedicated charging solutions can have high added value. But these down and upstream activities also ask for large investments in R&D and production. History proves that one model failure can put the existence of a whole car company at stake. For instance, in 1958, the failure of the new Edsel brought the mighty Ford in great trouble. Good and sustainable product planning is of imminent importance for a long-term success. In this transition phase, a lot of new companies will emerge and disappear. A lot of innovative ideas will fail deployment, not in the last place because of lack of funding. Good ideas are the key, but as frontrunner, it's even more difficult to realize a healthy business. Especially in automotive, success needs a long breath, deep pockets, and a good overall planning. A balanced product planning with a consistent production start from job one to full capacity. Looking at Tesla's production hell, the last point seems to be an increasing problem for them. With every new model, the delay gets longer, and also quality issues seem to increase. Moreover, offering electric auto mobility is a business of well-synchronized systems. The new charging infrastructure and the new service network should be available in time. If one of the new elements is missing or is a misfit, the whole product offer can fail in practice. Also here, Tesla is a good, and in this time, positive example of a total system approach. Their co-developed worldwide supercharging network is as important as the appealing cars. Electrification of road transport is not only means high cost in development. Also, the capital-intensive production facilities make financial risk of a product failure high. This is also true for suppliers to the OEMs and the companies in the charging infrastructure. Small may be beautiful, but in automotive, because of the intrinsic investments, size counts. This is why existing OEMs are hesitative. They prefer a well-planned big step in e-mobility. With the current announcement of dozens new electric cars in the next 5 years as a result. But there is much more than the passenger car. In the truck and bus sector, there has always been retrofitting activities by small companies. Chassis design and lower volume assembly make those vehicles relatively easy to electrify. So if the market asks for heavy EVs, the truck and bus OEMs will follow very fast. A nice case is the VDL Enabling Transport Solutions, a new division with over 100 engineers. Also BYD, Volvo and Solaris already stepped in this business. There starts to be a market. Finally, Daimler Trucks and Buses bundled the know-how for electric propulsion system. E-Mobility Group is the name of a new global organization of Daimler's utility vehicles. Trucks and buses of 80 ton and more are about 10 times more energy consuming than cars. A lower total cost of ownership over a long service period is the killer argument in this sector. This and zero emission cities will make transporters or operators choose electric in little time. On the other side of the spectrum, especially popular in China, are the light electric vehicles. For this course, we will focus on the automotive four-wheelers in the EU categories L6E and L7E. This is the category smaller than the compact city car or the delivery van with 2-3.5 ton max weight. Often, light electric vehicles are limited in speed, so they may be driven by chauffeurs without a driving license. Depending on the class, the maximum power is 15 kilowatt and the payload is 750 or 1200 kilogram. The problem of this segment is that due to the small production, they are relatively expensive. European examples are the hip Renault Twizy and the Groupil that Picnic uses for groceries. But also the DL street scooter, the PostNL Stint, and the Rivian Park Shuttle are successful. Moreover, these small vehicles are very suitable for automated driving. The relatively TCO benefit of avoiding driver cost is high. That's the reason that self-driving pods are an attractive last-mile solution for people or cargo. Small vehicles, but a promising low-energy niche that can benefit a lot from electrification. Thank you very much.